Hello and welcome dear students. Today I am going to teach you climate change. The earth's climate is dynamic and always changing through a natural process. What the world is more worried about is that the changes that are occurring today have been speeded up because of man's activities. These changes are being studied by scientists all over the world who are finding evidence from tree rings, pollen samples, ice cores and sea sediments. Climate change is a significant and lasting change in the statistical distribution of weather patterns over periods ranging from decades to millions of years. It may be a change in average weather condition or in the distribution of weather around the average conditions. Factors that can shape climate are called climate forcings or forcing mechanisms. Forcing mechanisms can be either internal or external. Internal forcing mechanisms are natural processes within the climate system itself, for example, the thermohaline circulation. External forcing mechanisms can be either natural, for example, changes in solar output, or they can be anthropogenic, for example, increased emissions of greenhouse gases. Whether the initial forcing mechanism is internal or external, the response of the climate system might be fast, for example, in case of a sudden cooling due to airborne volcanic ash reflecting sunlight. It can be slow, for example, thermal warming of ocean water, or it can be a combination, for example, sudden loss of albedo in the Arctic Ocean as sea ice melts. The causes of climate change can be natural or anthropogenic. Natural causes include ocean variability, ocean currents, continental drift, earth tilt, solar output, and volcanoes. Now coming to the first cause, ocean variability. The ocean is a fundamental part of the climate system. Some changes in it are occurring at longer time scale than in the atmosphere, massing hundreds of times more and having very high thermal inertia. Short-term fluctuations such as the El Nino Southern Oscillation, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, the North Atlantic Oscillation and the Arctic Oscillation represent climate variability rather than climate change. On longer time scales, alterations to oceanic processes such as thermohaline circulation play a key role in redistributing heat by carrying out a very slow and extremely deep movement of water and the long-term redistribution of heat in the world's oceans. Now coming to one more cause, that is ocean currents. Ocean currents move vast amounts of heat across the planet, roughly the same amount as the atmosphere does. Certain parts of the world are influenced by ocean currents more than others. The coast of Peru, for example, and other adjoining regions are directly influenced by the Humboldt current that flows along the coastline of Peru. The El Nino event in the Pacific Ocean can affect climatic conditions all over the world. Another region that is strongly influenced by ocean currents is the North Atlantic. Much of the heat that escapes from the oceans is in the form of water vapor. Yet, water vapor also contributes to the formation of clouds, which shade the surface and have a net cooling effect. Now, coming to one more cause, that is continental drift. Scientists believe that back then the earth was not as we see it today, but the continents were all part of one large landmass. Proof of this comes from the similarity between plant and animal fossils and broad belts of rocks found on the eastern coastline of South America and western coastline of Africa, which are now widely separated by the Atlantic Ocean. The discovery of fossils of tropical plants in the form of coal deposits in Antarctica has led to the conclusion that this frozen land at some time in the past must have been situated closer to the equator, where the climate was tropical with swamps and plenty of lush green vegetation. The drift also had an impact on the climate because it changed the physical features of the landmass, their position and the position of water bodies. This separation of land masses changed the flow of ocean currents and winds, which affected the climate. This drift of the continents continues even today as the Himalayan range is rising by 1 millimeter every year because the Indian landmass is moving towards the Asian landmass. Now coming to one more cause, that is Earth's tilt. The Earth makes one full orbit around the Sun each year. It is tilted at an angle of 23.5 degrees to the perpendicular plane of its orbital path. If there was no tilt, we would not have experienced seasons. Changes in the tilt of the earth can affect the severity of the seasons. More tilt means warmer summers and colder winters. Less tilt means cooler summers and milder winters. Actually, the axis of earth is not quite constant. It does move at the rate of a little more than a half degree each century. So, Polaris has not always been and will not always be the star pointing to the north. When the pyramids were built around 2500 BC, the pole was near the star Thuban, also known as Alpha Draconis. This gradual change in the direction of the Earth's axis, called precession, is responsible for changes in the climate. Now coming to one more cause, that is volcanoes. The volcanic activity may last only a few days, yet the large volumes of gases, water vapor, dust and ash can influence climatic patterns for years. Millions of tons of sulfur dioxide gas can reach the upper levels of the stratosphere from a major eruption. The gases and dust particles partially block the incoming rays of the sun, leading to cooling. Sulfur dioxide combines with water to form tiny droplets of sulfuric acid. These droplets are so small that many of them can stay aloft for several years. They are efficient reflectors of sunlight and screen the ground from some of the energy that it would ordinarily receive from the sun. Winds in the stratosphere carry the aerosols rapidly around the globe in either an easterly or westerly direction. Mount Pinatubo in the Philippine Islands erupted in April 1991, emitting thousands of tons of gases into the atmosphere. Another striking example was in the year 1816, often referred to as the year without a summer. Now coming to one more cause, that is solar output. The sun is the predominant source for energy input to the earth. Both long and short term variations in solar intensity are known to affect global climate. 3 to 4 billion years ago, the sun emitted only 70% as much power as it does today. If the atmospheric composition had been the same as today, liquid water should not have existed on earth. Over the following approximately 4 billion years, the energy output of the sun increased and atmospheric composition changed. Over the next 5 billion years, the sun's ultimate death, as it becomes a red giant and then a white dwarf, will have large effects on climate, with the red giant phase possibly ending any life on earth that survives until that time. Now coming to the anthropogenic causes of climate change. The Industrial Revolution in the 19th century saw the large-scale use of fossil fuels for industrial activities. More and more land was covered with vegetation, has been cleared to make way for houses. Natural resources are being used extensively for construction, industries, transport and consumption. Consumerism has increased by leaps and bounds, creating mountains of waste. Also, our population has increased to an incredible extent. Dear students, now coming to the greenhouse gases and their sources. Global warming results when certain gases in the atmosphere block and trap heat radiating from Earth towards space. Gases that contribute to the greenhouse effect include carbon dioxide, nitric oxide, methane, and chlorofluorocarbons. Now, carbon dioxide. Changes in land use pattern, deforestation, land clearing, agriculture and other activities have all led to a rise in the emission of carbon dioxide. Over the last century, the burning of fossil fuels like coal and oil has increased the concentration of atmospheric carbon dioxide. This happens because the coal or oil burning processes combines carbon with oxygen in the air to make carbon dioxide. To a lesser extent, the clearing of land for agriculture, industry, and other human activities have increased concentrations of greenhouse gases. Global emissions of carbon dioxide were at a record high in 2011. Dear students, now methane. It's another important greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. About 1/4 of all methane emissions are said to come from domesticated animals such as dairy cows, goats, buffaloes, camels, horses, and sheep. These animals produce methane during the cultivating process. Methane is also released from rice or paddy fields that are flooded during the sowing and manuring periods. Nearly 90% of the paddy growing area in the world is found in Asia, as rice is the staple food there. China and India, between them, have 80 to 90% of the world's rice growing areas. Methane is also emitted from landfills and other waste dumps. If the waste is put into an incinerator or burned in the open, carbon dioxide is emitted. Methane is also emitted during the process of oil drilling, coal mining, and also from leaking gas pipelines. Another important greenhouse gas, nitrous oxide. A large amount of nitrous oxide emission has been attributed to fertilizer application. This in turn depends on the type of fertilizer that is used, how and when it is used, and the methods of tilling that are followed. Contributions are also made by leguminous plants such as beans and pulses that add nitrogen to the soil. Dear students, now water vapor. The most abundant greenhouse gas, but importantly acts as a feedback to the climate. Water vapor increases as the Earth's atmosphere warms, but so does the possibility of clouds and precipitation, making these some of the most important feedback mechanisms to the greenhouse effect. Dear students, now chlorofluorocarbons. Synthetic compounds of entirely of industrial origin, used in a number of applications, but now largely regulated in production and released to the atmosphere by international agreement for their ability to contribute to destruction of the ozone layer. They are also greenhouse gases. Dear students, now how we all contribute every day? All of us in our daily lives contribute our bit to this change in the climate. For example, electricity is the main source of power in urban areas. All our gadgets run on electricity are generated mainly from thermal power plants. These thermal power plants are run on fossil fuels, mostly coal, and are responsible for the emission of huge amounts of greenhouse gases and other pollutants. Cars, buses, and trucks are the principal ways by which goods and people are transported in most of our cities. These are run mainly on petrol or diesel, both fossil fuels. We generate large quantities of waste in the form of plastics that remain in the environment for many years and cause damage. We use huge quantities of paper in our work, at school, and in offices. Have we ever thought about the number of trees that we use in a day? Timber is used in large quantities for construction of houses, which means that large areas of forest have to be cut down. A growing population has meant more and more mouths to feed, because the land area available for agriculture is limited. High yielding varieties of crop are being grown to increase the agricultural output from a given area of land. However, such high yielding varieties of crops require large quantities of fertilizers, and more fertilizers mean more emissions of nitrous oxide, both from the field into which it is put and the fertilizer industry that makes it. Now coming to the consequences of climate change. The first consequence of climate change can be seen in Europe and worldwide, and these impacts are predicted to intensify in the coming decades. Temperatures are rising, rainfall patterns are shifting, glaciers are melting, sea levels are getting higher, and extreme weather resulting in hazards such as floods and droughts is becoming more common. The first consequence is increase in global temperature. Global temperatures have risen by some 0.75 degree centigrade over the past 100 years. An increase of 2 degree centigrade above the temperature in pre-industrial times is seen by scientists as the threshold beyond which there is much higher risk, and possibly catastrophic changes in the global environment will occur. Warmer conditions will probably lead to more evaporation and precipitation overall, but individual regions will vary, some becoming wetter and others drier. Melting ice and rising seas. The world's oceans are warming up, expanding their volume. Polar ice sheets have started to melt, and glaciers around the world are shrinking. The combination of these changes is increasing sea levels, which in time will threaten low-lying land areas and islands. The decline in Arctic sea ice, both in extent and thickness, over the last several decades is further evidence for rapid climate change. In the Arctic, some sea ice remains year after year, whereas almost all Southern Ocean or Antarctic sea ice melts away and reforms annually. Satellite observations show that Arctic sea ice is now declining at a rate of 11.5% per decade. One more consequence, extreme weather and shifting rainfall. As the climate changes, extreme weather events like heat waves, droughts, heavy rain and snowstorms and floods are becoming more frequent or more intense. Rainfall patterns also changing. In Europe, the Mediterranean area is becoming drier, making it even more vulnerable to drought and wildfires. Northern Europe, meanwhile, is getting significantly wetter and winter floods could become common. Now, dear students, let's know the vulnerable regions. Vulnerability to climate change varies widely across regions. Many poor developing countries are among the most vulnerable to climate change and also have the least resources to cope with it. European regions that are particularly vulnerable to climate change include Southern Europe and the Mediterranean basin due to heat and droughts. Second one, the Alps due to rapid melting of snow and ice. Third one, coastal zones, deltas and floodplains due to sea level rise, intense rainfall, floods and storms. And the fourth one, Europe's far north, the Arctic and outermost regions due to increased global warming. Dear students, let's know the impacts of climate change on human health, economy and wildlife. Some crops and other plants may respond favorably to increased atmospheric carbon dioxide, growing more vigorously and using water more efficiently. At the same time, higher temperatures and shifting climate patterns may change the areas where crops grow best and affect the makeup of natural plant communities. Extreme weather events such as heat waves and floods pose a direct risk to the health and safety of people, with the very young, the elderly, the disabled and low-income households particularly vulnerable. Damage to property and infrastructure imposes heavy costs on society and economy. Sectors that rely strongly on certain temperatures and precipitation levels such as agriculture, forestry, energy and tourism will be particularly affected. Climate change is happening so fast that many plant and animal species will struggle to cope. Warming of 1.5 degree centigrade to 2.5 degree centigrade beyond today's levels would put as many as 20-30% of plant and animal species at increased risk of extinction. Different species of beetles tend to be found under different climatic conditions and can be used as indicators of past climatic conditions. Similarly, the historical abundance of various fish species has been found to have a substantial relationship with observed climatic conditions. Changes in the primary productivity of autotrophs in the oceans can affect marine food webs. A gradual increase in warmth in a region will lead to earlier flowering and fruiting times, driving a change in the timing of life cycles of dependent organisms. Conversely, cold will cause plant biocycles to lag. Larger, faster, or more radical changes, however, may result in vegetation stress, rapid plant loss, and desertification in certain circumstances. Climate change devastated the tropical rainforests abruptly, fragmenting the habitat into isolated islands and causing the extinction of many plant and animal species. Changes in the type of pollen found in different layers of sediment in lakes, bogs or river deltas indicate changes in plant communities. These changes are often a sign of a changing climate. Now, the preventive measures for climate change. Global warming consequences are thus too serious to be ignored. The Earth has gone through cycles and survived several ice ages. Despite the controversy, governments are taking steps to protect the environment. An attempt is being made to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and to penalize the emitters by means of Kyoto Protocol, which was initiated for the first time in 1997. In several countries, the law requires that each fell tree must be replaced by planting 2 new saplings. At an individual level, we too can contribute. For example, we can reduce energy use. The energy you use at home and work contributes to increased levels of carbon dioxide. Usually, fossil fuels are burned to produce and transport the energy, releasing greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. The first thing the US Environmental Protection Agency recommends is changing out standard light bulbs for compact fluorescent or LED lights, which use up to 75% less energy and last longer. You can also upgrade heating and cooling systems and insulate your home properly to make sure your home is not wasting energy. To reduce dependence on fossil fuels, buy green power, which is produced from renewable sources like solar or wind. Update buying habits. The way you shop and the products you buy can contribute to global warming. The EPA recommends buying Energy Star certified products when you can buy used products and items with recycled content and minimal packaging. When it comes time to throw away items, try to recycle them or donate them to another source so that they don't end up in a landfill. Be mindful of food waste and try to compost leftover food scraps. Incineration of biodegradable materials also releases pollutants. Change transportation habits. To reduce your emissions, change your driving habits. The easiest way to cut carbon emissions is to drive less, take public transportation, walk or ride a bike. Keep your car maintained so that it runs efficiently. Turn off your car instead of idling and don't drive aggressively, as abrupt acceleration and driving at high speeds burns up fuel. Stop deforestation. Deforestation is a major contributor to global warming. When large expanses of forest are cut or burned, carbon dioxide, a greenhouse gas, is released into the atmosphere. Because trees also take carbon dioxide from the air, cutting down large numbers of trees causes carbon dioxide levels to rise even further. Although much of the major deforestation is taking place in tropical areas, you can take action to help prevent further loss. Support politicians who champion reforestation projects and donate to organizations that promote foreign forest management. With this, we conclude today's lecture. Hope you enjoy.